Good morning, Harmony Grove.
Good morning.
Let me be the first to wish you a happy Reformation Day. It's on this day, October 31st, 1517, that Martin Luther, he nailed his 95 Rices to the church door. Man, you guys are not awake. I thought that was good. Not Rices, thesis, and that's where we get the Protestant church. So happy Reformation Day to you and you all. Couple announcements as we begin. Give you an update on Faith Promise. Our Faith Promise is up to just a tick under $28,000 for the upcoming year. As many of you know, through Faith Promise is how we set our missions budget. It's giving we do by faith above and beyond our normal giving that goes 100% to missions. So if you've not gotten those in, you have two more Sundays. You can put those sheets in one of our giving stations around the church. And if you need a Faith Promise sheet as you pray through that, they're in the back just under the TV in the lobby. Couple of upcoming dates. Saturday, November 20th is our fall cleanup. This is the day we do leaves. Guys, what do you think about the leaves? We'll have a great Sunday, hopefully, or Saturday. Hopefully the leaves are down by then, but you can mark your calendars for that. A new date, November 24th, Thanksgiving Eve. We are gonna have a service. We're gonna do what we did a couple years ago. We're gonna have a praise and pie night. This will take place up in the fellowship hall. And this is how praise and pie night works. We come, we give thanks for all the things God has done throughout the year. We sing, we have a message. My favorite part is we allow you to give testimonies. And then we pie, or we enjoy some fellowship with one another. Y'all supply the pie, I'll supply the alamode. One, you don't want me, you don't want to eat my pie anyway.
I don't like pie.
You can, I can't.
I don't like pie.
But you know what? When you have some pie, some ice cream is nice on the side, so I'll supply that. So again, praise and pie night is the 24th. And then our final announcement, next Sunday is daylight savings. And this is where we fall back. We gain an extra hour of sleep.
Yes.
Yeah, that is a yes.
Yay!
Yay!
So if you forget, that's okay. Maybe you've been forgetting to come to Sunday school, and then you have an extra hour. You have time to get here for Sunday school, right? Because you just gained an extra hour of sleep. So why don't you, for some of you, you've been wanting to get back to Sunday school. You know it's happening. We've started up a couple weeks ago, and you know the spirit is willing. The body's just a little weak. You haven't quite gotten there. Great week to start back to Sunday school. Use that extra hour. Come an hour early. Join us for Sunday school. Hey, those are our announcements. Terry's going to pray. We'll begin singing in a moment.
Good morning. Y'all pray with me? Father God, we do thank you for this morning. It may be chilly and wet outside, but the sun is shining here in our midst, and we're grateful for him. We ask, God, that you would just open our hearts. Let us hear with our hearts as well as our ears the praise for you, the word. Let the word just permeate who we are, and that we can hear what you would have us to do and to change and to be as we move through this week. Lord, we love you. We are grateful for you. We are grateful for Jesus and the sacrifice that he made for us. And it's in his name that I pray. Amen. If y'all will stand. We'll try to sing.
Let the king of my heart be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from, oh, he is my song. Let the king of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life, oh, he is my song. You are good, good, oh,
It is amazing when you sit and think that it is the breath of the Creator who takes our breath and makes us who we are. In our Wednesday night trek, we're learning about how God has made us, how we are fearfully and wonderfully made, and we are made the way he wanted us to be. We don't have to apologize for who we are because God has created us in the way he wants us to be. And that's frightening sometimes, and it's also very humbling, and we are grateful for who he is, and we need to remember that we are special because he loves us.
All right, I got it. She's gonna love it. Let's go.
Whoa, how'd you find a card so fast?
I am a speaker of lady language. I hear their voices in my head, much like Beethoven heard music.
No, I think those are just voices.
Either way, I've got a card, and you don't.
I'm trying to find one with the right words. I can't find one that really describes how I feel.
Here, this one.
This one. This is the one.
Yeah.
Okay. Sugar is sweet and so is honey. I bought you this card because I had no money.
That is so you.
No, it's not.
Yes, it is.
No, it's not. It's not me.
What are you trying to say?
I need a card that says, I don't deserve you. I never have, and I never will. From the moment that I first saw you, I knew that I wanted to be with you, to know you, to understand you. I am humbled that you chose me. I have married out of my league, and there's not a day that goes by that I don't recognize that fact. And I've never taken our vows lightly. What do I say to the mother of my children, my best friend, my soulmate? I love you can just sound so cliche and trite, but it's the only words that I know. I love you. I mean, that would be a card, you know? That would be a card that I'd want to buy. What's the matter? What happened?
Don't look at me.
Okay.
Look away.
I have. What's the matter?
It's like I'm a swimming pool, and your words are like cannonballs landing. Pull yourself together, man. Attention, everybody. We are in the presence of a true wordsmith.
No, we're not.
Allow his words to be the wings on which your cards fly.
No.
I want what he's having.
Okay, we need to go. We need to go right now.
I've got an idea. We'll get those cards that are blank on the inside, and we'll write your words on them, and then we'll give them to our ladies. But we have to write in calligraphy.
I'm just going to take your card.
Wait. What was that part about the true soulmates? I need a pen. I gotta write this down. That stuff is gold. That'll give me a whole Sunday of football.
How do you follow that up? I love this video because it reminds you of a simple premise. Words say a lot, actions say more, right? God has been so gracious to us that he doesn't just love us in words, but God loves us in action. So we are to be genuine with one another, not just to say we love or say we care, but they will know we are Christians by our love and our love in action. So we ask ourselves, how do we love more genuinely? How do we care more deeply? How do we do so not just in word only, but also in deed? So let us pray, and then we will get into our Bible study this morning. So, Father, we thank you. You are good. God, that you so loved us that you sent us your Son, that his body was broken, his blood was shed for us, that you didn't just tell us you loved us in words, but you showed real love through sending Christ to this earth, that Jesus died for our sins, that we should love and care for one another. So, Lord, meet us here, we ask. In Jesus we pray, amen. We are in Colossians chapter 3, picking up right in the middle of the chapter there, verse 12 through 17. It says, therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, put on tender mercies, kindness, humility, meekness, long-suffering, bearing with one another and forgiving one another, if anyone has a complaint against another, even as Christ forgave you, so you also must do. But above all these things, put on love, which is the bond of perfection. And let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to which you were called in one body, and be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. And whatever you do, in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. You have your bulletin, you want to follow along. Our first point is putting on. Begins the word therefore. Picking up on last week, therefore we set our minds on the things above, not on the things of this earth. We understand the propaganda, we understand the advertising, we understand that the world's message is constantly trying to get within us. It's easy to be set aside, to get distracted. So therefore, as the elect, as the chosen of God, therefore those who put our faith in Jesus as our Savior, holy and beloved. Holy is our character, that we're pure, that we're right before God. Beloved is our actions, that we are known as Christians by our love. We put on the things of God. And this is the kind of the outline for the next two words. Holy, our character, the things we put on here is verse 12. Beloved, our actions is going to be reflected in verse 13. So therefore put on, and this picks up on the same illustration from last week. Last week we put off the things of this world. If you were here, you might remember the illustration I used with Butch, our chairman of our elder board, also our resident farmer, that before he comes to church on Sunday mornings, he goes out and he feeds the animals. But he doesn't just put his church clothes on top of his farm clothes, because if he did, well, we'd all catch a whiff of him on Sunday morning. Before he comes, he puts off all those farm clothes, those filthy clothes. He cleans up, and thankfully he puts on a new nice shirt, and then he comes to church. So as Christians, we don't put the things of Christ on top of the things of the world. We don't just put those things on for Sunday mornings, thinking that if we live like the world just with Christ on top of us, we can fool people. No, no, no. We are called to completely cast those things aside, to get rid of the things of the world, the anger, the malice, the so on and so forth. And these are the things that we are called to put on. The idea of putting on is like dressing for winter. How many of you have gotten out your winter clothes? You made that switcheroo from the summer clothes to the winter clothes. I still got to do that. Before coming here, I used to be a pastor up in Buffalo. And the idea of surviving the winters in Buffalo can be summarized in one word: layers. Some of you are getting cold already talking about that. Because here's the truth about winter. You could have a jacket on, you could have a hat on, but if you don't have gloves on, you're still cold. That snow still goes right through you. The idea is, you know, you got to dress in layers. The idea of these characteristics is we don't pick and choose which one. We actually layer these things in our lives. Right? So, verse 12. Therefore, as the elect, the chosen of God, holy and beloved, put on, layer your life in these characteristics: tender mercy, kindness, humility, meekness, and long-suffering. So the first layer, the base layer, perhaps the most important layer for us as Christians, for us in the church, is to put on tender mercies. Now, the interesting thing about tender mercies, it sounds like the same thing. A definition from Strong's Concordance is tender mercies is bowels. It's intestines, the heart, lungs, liver, etc. The bowels were regarded as the seat of the more violent passions, such as love. So in other words, if you lived in Bible times and you wanted to get the perfect Mother's Day or anniversary card for your spouse, man, you might get a card that would say, "Honey, I love you with all of my bowels." I love you like I love my intestines. How do you think that would go over on your anniversary? I have not seen that Hallmark card yet, have you? But the idea of putting on tender mercies is this is the passionate side of you. So if I were to translate this, put on, I might actually say something like this in 2021, that we are to love one another genuinely. Right? So as Christians, as people who are set apart by God, put on genuine love towards one another. That makes a little bit more sense, doesn't it? And the idea of being genuine, this is the foundation for all the characteristics, for all the other aspects of your life. Right? So being genuine, in genuine love, be humble. In genuine love, be meek. In genuine love, be long-suffering or be patient towards one another. Nod your head if that makes a little bit more sense to you. Because some of you, I start reading this definition, you're like, man, where's he going with that? I don't know. Again, you're all a little bit like tired and dreary. I'm trying my best here, so meet me halfway. Because if we put on humility without being genuine, that comes across different, doesn't it? That comes across like you're being forced to do something as opposed that God has worked in your heart and you genuinely want to do something. For example, think of it this way. If you don't have genuineness, if you don't have tender mercy, it's like passing the vegetables at the family dinner. I'm not sure how vegetables go at your dinner. This is how they sometimes go at my dinner. Charlotte takes time and makes genuine, you know, good vegetables. She wants her family to be healthy. But we pass them around, and if mom's not looking, you know what happens to those vegetables? Man, they can come around the whole table like that. But sometimes you're looking at the kids. And you know what? They put enough vegetables on the plate so they won't get yelled at, so they can pass it on. They don't genuinely want to eat them, do they? So they put a mouthful of green beans and they take a big swig of whatever their water, juice, soda situation is just to get them down. And as Christians, that's not how we should come across to people. Like we feel guilty by God, so we're doing an act of kindness towards one another. As God is been gracious to us, so we are genuine to one another. We don't love people just in words, but we let our actions show that we love and care for other people. Amen? So we put on these things, but we put on these things with a layer, the base of genuine love. As God has been gracious to us, so we are genuine to one another. So verse 12 is the characteristics as Christians we should have. In verse 13, these are the actions we should show. So our first action is bearing one another. Some of you might remember this from our summer series. The idea of bearing literally means to hold up or to hold back. Some of your translations actually have the word forbearance. I believe that's how the King James translate it. And God is forbearing towards us. Right? As sinners, we deserve God's wrath. God doesn't strike us with lightning bolts. He holds back his hammer upon us. So as we come to church today, none of you are probably worried about getting struck by a lightning bolt through the ceiling. Number one, God doesn't strike people to the third point. And two, I'd appreciate if the Lord would strike you in the parking lot and not through our nice new ceiling, right? But this is what God does to us. We are sinners. We deserve God's wrath. God holds off. God gives us second, third, 50th chances. God doesn't wish that any should perish, but all should come to repentance. And as God is gracious with us and gives us second and third chances, so because he genuinely loves us, we genuinely love one another, and we are gracious to them. Because here's the thing about being a church, right? We got five generations of people in the church. Amen. We like having kids. We like having seniors. We like having everybody in between. We have people who are newer and younger to their faith, right? We have some of you who have been walking with the Lord longer than I've been alive. Amen? Right? Yeah, some of you are laughing. It's true, right? So we're all at different places. So sometimes those of us who are older in our faith or more mature in our faith, we have to be gracious to one another. We have to set the example. We have to be patient and meek, realizing that, you know what, they're just not there yet, and that's okay. God's still working on their heart. And you know what, I'm going to be loving to them, even though they're not, they don't get it, because God has been loving and gracious towards me. Because sometimes it's easy to come to church and say, hey, we should do this, or everybody should listen to me, or we should do it this way. And we got to realize that, you know, God calls us to be genuine and to be bearing with one another, that when, you know, we're at different places, that as God has been gracious to us, so we're genuine and we're gracious to other people. And we just don't tolerate one another. We love one another. And this is hard, isn't it? Because sometimes we've been taught in our culture, no. You are right. You are the customer. You should have it your way. And you should have it right now. And that's not how church works. In fact, church works just the opposite. That they will know we are Christians by our love, that we're not just called to come and consume, or, you know, some of the pastors would say, sit, soak, and sour. No. We're called to bear with, and out of our love for Christ, to serve one another. And that's when the church works the best, right? When it isn't all about me, it's, but no, how can I help love and care for God's people? So, as God has been gracious in your life, so you are genuine and you care for one another, the first thing we do is we bear with one another. We don't drop the hammer on people. We don't try to squish people or make them get in line. No, we love and care for one another. We do so through our actions. And the second thing we are called to do, We're just going to keep it moving. The second thing we're called to do here is we are called to forgive. Bearing with one another, forgiving one another. And the interesting thing about forgiving in this verse is it doubles down. It even gives you an explanation. You know, if someone has a complaint against one another, even as Christ forgave you, so you also, what does your Bible have there? What's that word? Must do. Right? This isn't the 8-year-old forgiving. Parents, grandparents, you all know what I'm talking about, 8-year-old forgiving. Have you ever seen your son or your grandson do something and it just horrified you as a parent? And what do? You grab them and you say, okay, you're wrong. You must go and apologize. And you turn them around and what do?
Sorry.
Sorry for what? And that's the model of forgiveness we model, right? By the way, we're trying to teach them at a young age that, you know, when you do wrong, you ask for forgiveness and you try to make it right. And sometimes in the church, we do this in our own hands. And we do it two ways, right? The first, sometimes we say things and we don't mean them, right? Sometimes we can offer forgiveness, but we can hold a grudge. By the way, is that genuine? I thought everything was okay. I thought they forgave me. But the way they're acting towards me, right, says something else. By the way, have you ever been on the receiving end of that, right? Hey, I thought everything was okay. I thought we talked it out, but now they're acting all weird. You know why they're acting all weird? Because they said they forgave you, but what happened? They didn't. That's hard, isn't it? And the second thing is, sometimes when we apologize, we do something like this. Think back to yesteryear, and maybe you've done this with your kids or your grandkids. I'm sorry, but you just make me so angry. See what happened there? That was a two-parter. We said, I'm sorry, and then there's that little three-letter word in the middle. What was that letter word? But. We say we're sorry, but it's not really my fault, and we try to place blame on other people. Not that you would ever do that. Maybe that's just me and my household. Is that genuine? And the answer is no. I mean, aren't we glad God doesn't do that with us? Hey, I will forgive you this time, but I'm going to require 3 Our Fathers and 5 Hail Marys. You know what? That was a big one. You know what? I'm going to forgive you, but I'm going to require that you slide an extra 5% into the offering plate for the next 6 months. You know what? I'm going to forgive you for that one, but I'm going to require that you actually go upstairs and help the kids out on Sunday mornings. God doesn't do that with us, does he? I mean, this is what it says here. But above all, bearing with one another, forgiving one another, if anyone has a complaint against one another, even as Christ forgave you, so you must also do. So how does God forgive us? He forgives us completely. He forgives us with no strings attached. When we're in Christ, we're a new creation. The old is past. Behold, God makes us brand new. As God has been gracious to us, so we are to be genuine with one another, so we are to forgive one another. And you're like, I don't feel like forgiving. Well, I'm glad God didn't base his forgiveness on me on feelings that day. That God so loved you, he sent his son, that Christ went to the cross. Well, we'll remember this in a few moments with communion. And as to the ends that God has forgiven you, so you must forgive one another. But above all, verse 14. Some of you probably heard sermons where pastors would pound the pulpit and said, hey, if you only get one thing out of today's message, get this. Or some of you may have heard sermons, if you're taking notes, make sure you jot this one down. Right? And Paul, he makes it really easy for me because he says, like, above all, this is the most important thing. By the way, what is the most important thing that you tithe every month? Is that what it says? That you stand and you sit when you're supposed to stand and sit. No. Above all, put on love. Again, this isn't the type of love that we express through words or we give in cards. This is the type of love that is seen through our actions. Put on love, which is the bond of perfection. If we are thinking about the put off, put on illustration, where Birch would put off the farm clothes and he puts on the good clothes, the bond of perfection when he puts on the good clothes, this is the belt that would hold everything together. Right? This is the first layer. This is the layer everything is centered around for. That they will know we are Christians by our love. It also has the idea, which is the bond of perfection. Another way you could probably translate this, but you shouldn't translate this way because you kind of lose that belt illustration. But other places, this would be translated, this is the sign of maturity. Right? So above all, put on love. This is the sign of maturity in your faith and life. That people know you are Christians, that people understand your walk, that people see your relationship with God, not through how you post it on Facebook, not through your pictures on Instagram. No. They see your maturity in Christ because they see the actions lived out in your life. As God has been gracious towards you, they see genuine love towards people in this church. They see genuine love towards your family members. They see genuine love towards people in the community. So, we reflect upon our lives. Who is God calling you to love? Right? Who in your life needs to see the hands and feet of Christ lived out in you? Who in your life needs to experience God's love and grace this week? And maybe, you know, God's calling you to care for and look out for someone here at our church. Or maybe it's a family member, or maybe it's, you know, someone at work tomorrow morning. But above all, we live out our life through love in Christ Jesus. If you're taking notes, this is our second point, verse 15. It says, "And let the peace of God rule in your hearts, which you are called in one body, and be thankful." So let the peace of God, what is peace? Well, the peace of God is that supernatural calm or tranquility. It's that when you're in the storms of your life, you experience the freedom from worry that comes through the Holy Spirit living inside of you. By the way, we all go through storms. Some of you might think we've been through a year and a half storm, but we know that God is in control. We know that God is good, and it releases us to respond how the world responds. Right? Where it seems like our world is going from bad to worse, where it seems like the world is losing all their stuff and, you know, they're fretting away, we know that God is in control, so we do not worry. You might be thinking, hey, Pastor, that sounds good. How can I obtain this type of peace in my life? Because let's be honest, we could all use a touch more peace, could we not? How do we get the peace of God? Well, it comes from being in harmony with God. And you'll be saying, okay, good. Well, how do I get in harmony with God? I mean, we are at Harmony Grove Community Church. How do we get more harmony with God? Well, harmony comes from living out God's will in your life. And you feel like you're going deeper and deeper down the rabbit trail. Okay, how do I get harmony with God? It comes from living out His will. Well, what is God's will for your life? Right? Someone once asked Jesus a similar question. They said, hey, Jesus, this is a big book. How do I live it out? What's the most important part? And what did Jesus respond by saying? Love the Lord your God with all of your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and to love your neighbors, you love yourself. Right? How do you understand God's will for your life? Do we love God in just in word, or do we love God through actions? I mean, loving God isn't like getting a Hallmark card and say, hey, God, there you go. We square for another week? How do we love other people? Is it just through our words? Is it also through our actions? So when we love God this way, God sits on the throne of our heart, right? He's the one who resides in you, and He's the one who works in you through the inside out. And this is where God's peace comes from, when God sits on the throne of your heart. Problem for us is it's easy to get sidetracked, isn't it? It's easy to let the things of the world control our thoughts, control our heart. It's easy to allow screens to fill our time. It's easy to allow the message of this world to steal our joy. Right? And what happens is instead of, you know, rejecting it, we sometimes embrace it. The peace of God becomes fleeing to us. We chase the things of the world instead of chasing the things of God. By the way, thankfully God loves us. Thankfully God lives in us. Thankfully God has a plan for our life. And the idea is we can experience God's peace when we recenter our heart and our thoughts on the things of God and allow God to sit on the throne of our life. So what do? We love genuinely. How? We put these characteristics from verse 12 inside of us. We build up the actions of verse 13. That is, God has been gracious to you, so you're genuine towards one another. as God has called you, we change our thoughts, we change our heart, which also leads to changing our actions. Without the peace of God, without the love of God in front of you, it's hard to bear with one another. Without the love of God, without the peace of God inside of you, it's hard to forgive one another. And this is where we need God to transform us from the inside out. So how do we build up our lives? How do we allow Christ to sit on the throne of our hearts? Verse 16, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. The things that you are putting into your thoughts, the things that you're putting into your heart, needs to begin with the word of God. Again, there's so many messages from this world. We need God's thoughts to be our thoughts and his ways to be our ways. So how do we do this? In all wisdom, we do this in two ways, teaching and admonishing one another. In psalms, hymns, spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. So there's two ways we get this inside of us, right? One is teaching, one is admonishing. And you might be thinking, Pastor, it kind of sounds like the same thing. And it is. It's two ideas for the same thought. One is the positive and one is the negative. Right? So teaching and admonishing. Teaching is the formal instruction. This is why things like church are so important to us. Because throughout the week, it's easy to get sidetracked. It's easy to get off, our direction off. And we need times in our life where we come and we recenter our hearts on the things of God. Right? We are prone to wander. We are prone to let wrong messages in our life. So we need time where we formally come and we learn and we're discipled and we're built up and we're instructed in our faith. This is why in Hebrews it says, hey, don't forsake meeting together. Y'all got to get together. And we got to get together for two reasons. One, to have Christ's word dwell in us richly, to be taught and understand the words of God for our life, and to live it out in real life faith. So that's the positive. The flip side is the negative, is admonishing one another. And when we come to church, the idea is that we're not just coming to hear a message, but ultimately we're coming to the living community, that we build one another up, that we encourage one another, that people know us. One of the great things about small groups in our churches, circles are better than rows, that when we get together and we sit in circles and we share real life, we get to know one another. And this is the reason we need to know one another, because every once in a while, we're going to need to be admonished. We're going to go off track, and we need someone else in our life to know us, to call us out on that, and to get us back on track. It's like when you see your kids doing something dangerous, what do you say? Ah, you know what? We're just going to let that go and see how it plays out. No, we don't need another trip to the ER. When we see our kids doing something dangerous, what do? We call them out on it. Why? Because we know the consequences, you know, have real life ramifications. We come to church to hear and receive the word of God, but we also come to church to live in community. We are known and we can be known. Why? Because, you know, other people are going to see things in us, and we got to not just come and sit and leave, but we got to come and be known so people can interact with us in that way. And by the way, we all need help. There's going to be times where we call other people out. There's going to be times we call other people call us out. It's called love, isn't it? Why do we discipline our kids? Because we love them. Why do we let other people know us? Because it helps our faith. So, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. We teach, we admonish the things of God. Oh, there's admonish. And whatever you do, in word or in deed, again, we love in word, but we also love in deed. We do all in the name under the authority of our Lord Jesus. Laws come into existence in our country. When the president signs them and by his name, things become law. Right? We serve a much greater authority in our life. And when we do things not in our name or in our church's name. We do things in the name under the authority of our Lord Jesus Christ. Because God so loved you, he sent his son, that his body was broken, his blood was shed for you. That Jesus died for your sins, was buried, And on the third day, Jesus rose again. As he arose, someday we too will rise. We'll spend an eternity in heaven. As he arose and we put our trust in Jesus as our Savior, he gives us his Spirit to work on us from the inside out. And as we go and we love, not just in word, but genuinely, we do so in the authority in the name of Jesus. We're going to ask a couple questions. We're going to go into communion. But I want to kind of end with that, that we do things because God so loved us first. He sent us his Son. So for ourselves, as we end this message, you know, who in the church is God calling you to change your attitude towards? Right? We put on these things. These are the ways we act. We bear with one another. We forgive one another. You know, is there someone in this church God is calling you to change your heart towards and bear with and realize, you know what, we're all in the same places, but as God has been gracious to us, you know what, I'm going to be genuine towards them and love them, even though we may be different. Who is God calling you to change your attitude towards? Who is God calling you to forgive? Not, I forgive you and you hold on to it. But as God has forgiven you, who is God calling you to change your heart towards and to forgive? And if God has given you somebody, if God is putting someone in your heart, you know, if God is something in your heart, you need to work something out. We don't come to communion, you know, flippantly, but look, we examine our hearts and we examine our lives. And maybe in examining your heart and examining your life, God is putting someone in your heart that you need to make right with this morning. You know, what does Jesus say? You know what? If you have something against your brother, better you leave your sacrifice on the altar and you go and you make right with your brother. Because they'll know we're Christians by our love. And you know, in love, who do you need to change your attitude towards this morning? And secondly, who in the church is God calling you to love? To care for. To be patient with. To be gentle with. You know, above all, what are we supposed to do? Put on love. This is the sign of maturity in your life. As you look around, who are you called to care for? Who are you called to come alongside with? You know, who are you called to admonish this morning? If God is putting someone on your heart, if God is showing you someone that you are to love through action, write that person's name down. Let's start living out our faith just a little bit more this morning. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for you are good. As you have loved us, so we love one another. As you've been gracious to us, so we are genuine towards one another. As you have loved us in action, so let our actions speak your love to one another. Father, as we take communion here in a couple of moments, allow us to examine our hearts and examine our lives to see how we are called to love one another even a little bit more. So it's in Jesus we pray. Amen. What we're going to do is we're going to stand. We're going to sing the first two verses of Have Thine Own Way. Elders, you can come forward, and we're going to prepare for communion. So stand up and sing with us.
Thank you.
can have a seat. For as often as you eat this bread and you drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. There we go. The way we proclaim the Lord's death isn't just through our words, but it's through our actions. For some of you, you are the only Christian some people may ever see. You can advance to the next slide, please. For some of you, you're the only Bible some people may ever read. Therefore, whoever eats this bread or drinks this cup in the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. So let a man or a woman, let him examine himself or herself. And so let him eat of the bread and drink of the cup. Whoever eats and drinks in an unworthy manner eats and drinks judgment on himself. So how is your heart this morning? Is basically what they're saying. We don't want to just sing of God's love and then our actions don't reflect God's love. And this is why we come to church. We come to church to set our mind on the things above. We come to church to put on the things of Christ. We come to church to realign our hearts and our thoughts and our life in the things of Jesus. And this is why communion is this great observance. It's this great reminder that if you've put your trust in Jesus, this is where we get our love for other people. Because God loved us first. That God so loved you, he sent his son. That whoever would believe in him should not perish but have everlasting life. That God didn't love us through words or through a card, but God loved us through his actions. That Jesus came born not in a palace, but of a virgin in a manger. Hey, we're getting close to Christmas. This Christmas stuff's going to start coming out, isn't it? That Christ came from humble beginnings. He shared and showed the love of God. And this is how much he loved you, that he went to the cross to pay for your sin. That we've all broken God's rules. We all need God's forgiveness. That Christ loved you so much, he laid down his life. And this is the example of how we love other people. I mean, if someone has no coats and you have two coats, what are you supposed to do? The person who has two coats, give a coat to the person who is in need. We just don't love through words, we love through actions. And this is Christ's love for us. Therefore, on the same night that Jesus was betrayed, when he had given thanks, he took the bread and he broke it and he said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Father, we thank you that you so loved us. You sent your son, that Jesus came and he lived and he went to the cross to pay for our sins, that his body was broken for us. So God, I pray that this element would be a reflection and an examination of our hearts. As we know and we take and we're reminded of Christ's love for us, are we so loving one another? So in this moment, allow us to pray, allow us to reflect, allow us to write in our hearts with you so that as we leave this morning, we will proclaim your death until Jesus comes again. So it's in Christ we ask. Amen. Gentlemen. So we take and we eat in remembrance of him. In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do it as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." That God so loved you that he sent his son, that his body was broken, but his blood was shed. And the blood, the shedding of blood, in a spiritual sense, it washes away your sin. Though we were dark, God washes us and makes us white as snow. That in Christ, we are a new creation. The old is gone and forgotten about. Everything you've done has been completely washed away. Christ makes us brand new. And sometimes we need to be reminded that God loves you as much on your best day as he does on your worst. That God is with you, that God never leaves you or forsakes you. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will not fear, for thou art with me. That God doesn't say, hey, when you get through this, I'll meet you on the other side. No, as we go through dark times, as we go through struggles, God goes there with us. That he leads and he guides and he strengthens us. That God never leaves you or forsakes you, that God cares about all of his children. And this is the powerful God that we have, that he doesn't love us through words, but that God loves us through action. And ultimately, his greatest action was bleeding and dying on the cross to take upon our sin, to be dead and buried and to rise on the third day. And this is why we come to church, because sometimes we need to be reminded of these things. We know them, you know, but sometimes with the things of this world, it's so easy to forget and it's so easy to get distracted, that as God has loved us, so we go and we love one another. So as you take this communion, as we drink the cup here in a second, I want you to reflect on God's great love for you. And as you drink it, I want you to be reminded that as God loves you, he is still with you. And as we leave, as God is with us, so he wants to share and wants us to show the love of God to somebody this week. Amen? Gentlemen. So we take and we drink in remembrance of him. It says that at the Last Supper, before Jesus and the disciples went out that night to the Garden of Gethsemane, they sang a hymn together. So I'm going to have Charlotte and Terry go back to the stage, and we're going to sing the final two stanzas of our closing hymn. So stand and sing with us as we close. Allow our hearts just to reflect those words, that we don't just love in words, but this week we love in actions. So have thine own way in our hearts. And Lord, as you lead us and you guide us, give us the faith, give us the obedience to step out and trust you, even if it's hard, even when it's loving someone else who's different than us. Have thine own way. So it's in Jesus we ask, amen.